Moderation in words, moderation in food, moderation in money. On the restaurant of this world, it is written, Anityam Asukham Jagat. So if you look for Nityam, if you look for Sukham, you are not going to get it. Do your duty. Be a good citizen of this country. Follow its culture. Respect and acceptance of all religions as just different pathways to the same God. See, he is the Adi Purush. He could have, you know, stuck on to that ancient wisdom and at any cost not allowed us to budge from him. No. But even then, that ancient wisdom, he made us learn to practice it in a modern way.
सद्गुरु साई राम जय बोलो सद्गुरु साई राम
I offer my loving salutations at the divine lotus feet of beloved Bhagavan Sai Ram to all of you. As Sai Sudha Narayan told you already, I have spoken in the divine physical presence of Bhagavan on more occasions than I can count. But each time, it was my style to talk on a subject of interest, something that I was interested in at the moment. So that is how everybody knew me. As a speaker, I would pick up a current topic and talk on that subject, even in Bhagavan's presence. I made only one exception. In 2005, 10th October, my mother and sister and I, we were having our brunch after the yagnam in the Purnachandra auditorium, and then I got a phone call that Bhagavan wants me to speak in the evening. Since that day happened to be my mother's birthday, I thought of mentioning her in some way, and that is the only instance. I won't tell you now about how I mentioned her, but that's the only time I broke that record, that I always speak only on a subject. I wanted to do the same today, but I came to know from the time I came yesterday that a lot of people would like to listen to personal experiences. And so I thought, forgive me, Swami, but I'll be breaking that today also. But I hope to still continue in my style because, you know, one style is one's own. So I would probably tell you about, she was saying 3 decades. It is more than 4 decades. So I want to tell you a little bit about how this whole journey began, how I came to Swami, and then if there is time, I will probably talk to you in my usual style, tell you about certain lessons that I learnt at Bhagavan's divine lotus feet. I was really fortunate to be born in a family that was very religious. At the time when I was born, my father was a big inspiration. He was a real bhakta. And since I was the youngest in the family at the time, I just kept watching him all the time. I heard the Bhagavad Gita for the first time. I heard the Bhagavatam for the first time sitting on his lap. He used to read the Bhagavad Gita every day, twice. The whole of the Bhagavad Gita. And he used to put me on his lap, even though I never understood at that time the meanings of the shlokas. I still heard them. And then he would read the Bhagavatam. And whenever he used to read the Bhagavatam, I used to, even if I am playing somewhere outside, I would hear his reading or recitation and I would run and come and sit on his lap, and that's how I heard the Bhagavatam. So though I was born and brought up abroad, I got an Indian upbringing because of my father. I'm talking to you about my father today because many years later, Bhagwan also told us, after my father passed away in 1991, that he was the one who brought you to Bhagwan. So, I must pay a tribute to my parents, to my father especially. And at that young age, because of my father's influence on me, you will be surprised if I tell you, I used to get up in the morning at 4 o'clock every day as a small girl and do meditation and japam. I used to just copy my father. I had school at 8 o'clock, but I would be ready before that, but I finish all that I need to do, and before everybody else gets up, I would be having my bath. There was no Swami in my life at that time. In despite that, I spent many years with that routine. So when I came to Bhagwan, some people say, you know, that you underwent a transformation. There was no metamorphosis in my case. Coming to Bhagwan was like a fulfillment. I was able to fit into that system because that's how I had lived. But, you know, even though at that young age, I used to often dream, get dreams of Sri Krishna talking to me or Rama, Sri Ram appearing to me and all that, I just had a deep inside feeling that I have still to meet my master. And I kept telling my father, when will he come and take me with him? Because, you know, at that time, I was born, by the way, in Kampala, Uganda, East Africa. There used to be a driving cinema in those days. And I think probably once in a year I must have watched a movie. You know, we were not like that. I mean, not brought up like that. So there was this Ramayana movie in which, you know, Sri Ram goes in one chariot and he goes up. And then, you know, I started crying in the car. And my father said, don't worry, God comes. He comes in his human form. And then he takes you up along with him in that chariot. So I was waiting for him to do that, to come and take me with him. So it was a waiting. First time I saw Swami was in 1968, in physical form when I saw him. Because Dr. C.G. Patel was our family doctor, and we never used to visit the clinic. My mother used to take us to his residence, which was very close to our house, and that's where I got all the time treated for a fever or whatever. And every time, you know, on the walls of his clinic, there used to be pictures of different saints, sadhus, and Swami's picture also used to be there. And not once, every time I visited the clinic, I used to ask my mother, who is this person? I have seen him before. And she said, no, he has not come here till now. He's Dr. Uncle's guru. But then who is he? Why do I feel each time I look at him that I've seen him before? And she kept telling me, no, why do you go on asking me this question? I've told you already, he has never come to, you know, Kampala. He's not. There were other saints whose pictures were there, and some of them had visited, but not Swami. So eventually, you see, in 1968, when Swami came to Kampala, unfortunately, my parents were in India. But we had the darshan. And afterwards, when my mother came back, the day Swami was leaving, they saw him at the airport. Because they were landing and Swami was leaving. And I told her, I saw him. And I'm sure he remembered me. I just had that feeling that I knew him from years before. And I told my mother, he will call me to him. He is the person. This is the master I was looking for. And so you see, after that, I did the meditation and the japam with a lot more rigor because I wanted Bhagwan to call me to him. You know, my father had the habit of putting on a shawl and then doing japam. Okay? And then he used to swing like that, you know, while he's doing the japam. So I thought that's how you're supposed to do it. So I told my mother, give me a shawl. I also want to put a shawl. And then I used to also swing and do it. And I used to ask my father, give me one name, I will do the japam. But, you know, not like my father. I used to get bored after 2-3 malas. And then say, tell me another name, you know, just like too many times I've been telling this. So he'll give me a whisper. Why do you disturb me? And I just tap him and sit next to him. And I just copied him throughout. So then, you see, then my father said, what's going on? Why are you doing this? And I said, no, you know, I have to prepare myself. I have to be ready when he calls. So I have to be more vigorous in my sadhana. Okay, so that is how I used to, and there was a picture in my room where I used to sleep. I used to sleep in the veranda in the back of the house because I used to get up so early it will disturb others. So I used to prefer to sleep there. And I used to go on looking at that picture and I kept telling him, when are you going to call me? When are you going to call me? Then you see in 1971, December, a few days before that, I got a dream in which Swami said, I'm calling you very soon. But I will give you a sign and you'll know that I have called you. Then in December, we were just sitting around a cup of tea in the evening. And my father said that my mother's sister, my Masi, was getting married in February next year, the following year, that is 1972. And so he said, why don't we all go to India? And then I thought, but I got a dream just a few days ago. And then Swami said that, you know, he will call me, but he hasn't called me yet. So, but then I didn't want to say no because I was also excited to go to India. And within a week, we decided to leave. Our tickets were booked. We came by ship. So I landed in Mumbai in 1972. And that's when I saw Dharma Kshetra for the first time. But then the interesting thing is, 2 years before that, Swami told the girls in Anantapur that 2 years from now, some girls are coming from East Africa to Anantapur. We didn't even know about that. So it was as if he had planned it all along, but we decided to come only December 1971. So our tickets were booked. We came by ship. And on the ship, the only thought that was disturbing me, otherwise I was very excited, was that I hadn't yet received a sign. And I'm still already on the way. So I used to stand on the deck of the ship and think, no, what is this? I mean, am I doing right? I should have told my father, no, let's wait, let's wait. Then while we were still on the ship, early hours of the morning, I got a dream in which Swami came and he stood on a rock and he smiled and he said, you're waiting for the sign? this is the sign. So he did that abhayasta, and he said, you are a loving daughter of mine, and that's why I'm calling you to me. So that gave me a lot of relief. Anyway, so we were visiting, and we didn't know anything about India. When we first landed at Mumbai, and I saw all those, you know, red patches, I didn't know that it was Pan, you know. And I told my mother, I mean, so much of bloodshed takes place in this country. You know, my father had given me such an idealized picture of India. I thought everybody in India, everybody is a saint. Honestly, that's what I thought. So I thought everybody is very good. So I have to be that kind of a person to be able to come to India, to deserve to be in India. So that is why I was preparing myself all those years. And here I got so surprised. Then my brother said, hey, don't exaggerate this. I said, but you know, Papa said, it's all, you know, Pan. But then why would anybody splash it on the wall? You know, it's so idealistic. You know, now we are talking of Swachh Bharat and all that. You know, this is what an outsider coming to India gets the first impression. So anyway, then from there we went by train. We reached Bangalore the following day, and we asked there at the Bangalore railway station where Swami is. And they said that he's in Whitefield. So we thought, okay, that's good. So we immediately arranged a taxi, and then we got into the taxi, and then we told him to drive as fast as it is possible, of course, given the traffic rules and whatever, but so that we would reach in time for the evening darshan. We didn't know anything about how it all happens, but we thought we would reach in time. Unfortunately, by the time we reached, Swami was already going inside his residence, so we just saw the back of his head, just the hair, and we were so disappointed that we didn't have his darshan on the day we arrived. Anyway, we were looking for some place to stay. You know, in that time in 1972, you can just well imagine how Kadugodi or Belthur was like. You know, we had to draw water from the well, and we got one small room, and we had to light a fire and make food for ourselves. Food was not easily available, literally not easily available. So you had to fend for yourself. But anyway, while we are standing there and wondering what to do, one distant cousin of mine, he's now in England, but you know, he was studying in Vrindavan at that time, Vrindavan College. And he appeared from the crowd. He was looking for us. So we said, how did you know that we have come? Because, you know, in those days, where did we have cell phones? Much less landline phones, and nobody made international calls. You know, they were too expensive, or you couldn't hear. Even now, people have the habit of talking on STD because they've got the habit of talking loudly. Even on cell phones, they talk loudly as if, you know, it can't be heard. Anyway. So you see, he came running, and then he said that just now, Swami told us that you have arrived. And he gave the exact number of people who had come. And he said, in that group, there are two schoolgirls. That is me and my sister Neela, who was, of course, who is elder to me, but she was, both of us were in school at that time. And he told my cousin that they have just arrived. Go and arrange their accommodation. Then I said, this is really strange, you know. Swami telling him, he has not seen us physically. We saw only the back of his hair, but he sees from all sides, he can see. And so he said, well, 10 days ago, Swami told me that your relatives are going to come to India. 3 days later, he said, they're already on the way. So he was keeping my cousin brother updated about our trip. We had not informed him at all. And throughout that period, you know, we got, those days there used to be just 40 people, 30 people in the Sai Ram shed for darshan. And so, you know, all the days we got first line. You know how all of us want to have the first line? So he used to talk to us and all that. But he didn't call us for an interview. Then I told my cousin, what is this? You said that Swami said two schoolgirls and then, you know, he's not calling us. Then he said, no. He told me yesterday, the previous day, he told my cousin brother, I'm going to ask those two girls to stay back and study in Anantapur. We were in school then. Then I got a little panicky, you know. I thought if Swami doesn't call, it's better. Because I was very attached to my parents. Coming to see Swami was one thing, but staying back and they going back, that was not acceptable. Okay, so somehow at that time, I got into a kind of a panic. Anyway, the day we were leaving, because that was the last possible day we had to leave Whitefield if we had to be on time for my Masi's wedding. Otherwise, it would be a wasted trip. The day we were leaving, that day Swami called us. And, you know, I used to wear frocks, of course, at that time. And I used to have two plaits. And I was so excited. I thought this is the first and last time I may have an interview with God. So I wanted to finish asking him all the questions, because in case I don't get another interview, because it's so rare to get an interview with Swami. So all the other elders, they all went in the front. I was sitting at the back. I don't know what he spoke to the others, but each time I was thinking of the question I wanted to ask Swami. So I used to walk up and then go to Swami. And personal, right? So I used to speak in his ears. So it's very childish. I didn't want anyone to know what he would answer, and then I go back and sit. Again, after some time, I get another question about what career I should take up, you know, because I may not get another interview. So I would walk up and go to Swami and speak in his ears. It happened a few times. Then Swami said, just sit here. Because, you know, instead of going every time coming back, so he said, sit here. And afterwards, he started by saying to my mother, I want to keep your daughters here. My mother was taken aback. At that time, there was no Swami school. I hope you know that, in 1972. Then she said, what, Swami? Then he said, these two girls, I want to keep them here. Then she said, but how can I keep them here? They're so small. I can't do that, Swami, because they're too small to stay by themselves. Then he looked at me and he said, see, I want to keep you here, but your mother is not listening. And I thought to myself, Swami, I hope my mother doesn't listen to you. Because after the darshan and all the grace, I can at least go back with my mother and come back whenever, you know, but not, I wasn't prepared to stay there. Everything was new, okay. But Swami was very insistent and he kept asking her. And several times this went on, this conversation, this dialogue between Swami and my mother. And she said, no, Swami, please, Swami, don't force me to keep my daughters here. Then he said, all right. Swami, if you want me to stay in Gujarat and educate them, I will do that. And I will send them to Anantapur when they are of college age. If you are ready for that, then I will stay back. I will not go back. Then Swami said, all right, it was a deal between my mother and Swami. And so, you see, she said, all right, then I will also stay. So then, all right, I mean, I thought, because you know, I was studying in one of the best schools there, and I was planning at that time. I'm telling you all this because I want to tell you that sometimes your life is not in your hands. It's in God's hands. He decides everything. I wanted to become an interpreter because I was very good in French. So I thought one day, you know, I go to Paris and get training and then I'll become an interpreter and all kinds of things I thought I would become. Of course, foreign service was one of the other options. I didn't think that I'll end up as a teacher, see? Anyway, so we went to Gujarat, and then after my Masi's wedding, my mother started looking for a house in Baroda. At that time, it was still called Baroda. And there was one newly constructed house in Alkapuri. Beautiful house. So my mother and my sister and me, we stayed back. And my sister-in-law and her son, they also stayed back. My brother and my father were back. So we were here. And we went and put the kalash there in the house. You know how you do something like your Graha Pravesh, you put the kalash? So that's what we did. After we came back, I got a severe stomachache for no reason. So I told my mother, I think it's not a good idea going and shifting in that house. Then she said, you just all the time keep imagining. They said, no, something is not right. We're not supposed to shift to that house. Next day, we got a telegram from my brother saying that my father was critical. He was very serious. And he asked my mother to come back. So in 2-3 days' time, they decided to return, leaving us behind. So my elder sister, another sister of mine who's now in Australia, she was of college age. She said, I will also study in Anandpur and you too can study in the school, whatever. But we were still looking for a school in Baroda, and we couldn't get admission into any school with the top grades that, you know, we had. See, that is Swami's plan. And then some Fatehpur or some place, we, you know, there was one school. My sister took us there, and elder sister, and then we saw that school, and I said, what? Do I have to study here? You know, I didn't want to, but it's any, you know, there's nothing you can do. But then when my mother and sister, sister-in-law and others went away, my sister said, let me go to Vrindavan or Puttaparthi, wherever Swami is, and ask him what to do. Now imagine at that time my sister was supposed to join in the first year degree course. So you can imagine what her age was. She took my cousin sister and one of my cousin brothers, and three of them, they set off from Baroda and came down to Puttaparthi. And this is 1972, and Vrindavan, I said. You know, the year when the summer course started, the first summer course, and the year when Mother Ishwarama also passed away. Now, Swami never, to my knowledge, has given interview to young people, young girls, alone. If it's in a group, it's all right. He's very particular about that. But he called them. And he gave an opportunity to my sister to ask him what to do with the other two younger sisters. We were still in Gujarat and they had come down. And do you know what he said? I told your mother to keep them here. She did not listen. So I had to create this drama to get them here. So you bring them now. So my father became fine after that. And then they continued to stay there, and we came to Anantapur. But he promised my sister, he told us to come by 4th of July. And he said, I will be there in Anantapur before you. You know, I didn't know Hindi. I knew Gujarati because my father used to insist you must know your mother tongue. So I knew Gujarati, I used to read, write, everything I could. I didn't know Hindi at all. So I knew French and then I knew English. Telugu was out of question. So you see, when we came to Anantapur, we just in broken Hindi, we communicated to them that there was to be horse carts, you know, we call them jatka, isn't it? So we got into that and we said, take us to the college, Satya Sai College. So he brought us there. And we reached the gate, there was a big crowd. Why? He had come, Bhagwan had already arrived 1 hour before us. He kept his promise. To my knowledge, till date, he has never broken his promises to us. He kept his promise to the detail. And we were not wearing saris. So we went to the hostel with our bags and decided to change. That time, you know, there were just about 50 girls, okay. I mean, you all don't even think of that strength. You know, 400, 450 girls now. Those days, just 50, 60 girls maximum. So every room, you know, we went to, it was empty. So we just got into some room because everybody was so busy with Swami's visit, nobody was around to guide us. So we just wrapped a sari around us and then we went to the college. We didn't know anybody, we didn't know the language, we didn't know what to do. We just saw the girls, they were also, you know, wearing no chappals on their feet, barefoot, and they were covering like this. And I thought, you know, like I'm nothing in front of them and like where have I come, you know, because I felt this is beyond me. When will I ever become like this? Okay, so then suddenly, you know, Swami came to that marble floor. All of you are familiar with that, the students. Came to the marble floor, and just when I was entering and I was thinking, now where do we go from here? He just came there. And the moment I saw him, because he was the only person I knew in the whole crowd, I just ran to him and fell at his feet and just sobbed. I cried because I felt like I was a sinking ship in a stormy sea. You know, didn't know the language, didn't know the culture, and I was thinking to myself, why did we ever come here? Then Swami, you know, patted us and then he said, don't worry, I will talk to them. And he called the principal and then he said, these two girls are supposed to go to the school and so get them admission. So she went to the school, and the only English medium school at that time in Anantapur, LRG school, English medium school, and she got us admission and we went there just to study. You know, we didn't go there to get admission. His Swami got the principal to get admission for us. Okay, I don't want to tell you so many things because, you know, throughout that period, I used to miss my mother. My father was a spiritual friend and I used to miss him, but I used to miss all the affection, you know, and the love and care of a mother, so. Whenever, not a single day it happened that this didn't happen. Whenever Swami came to Anantapur, which he used to do maybe once a month, twice a month, invariably they will declare a holiday at school. I don't know how that happened. I didn't miss a single darshan of Swami. So every time he came and I arrive at the college, and I come to know that Swami is on the way. So then, you know, I used to race, go to the hostel, because I was wearing my school dress, skirt and blouse, race, get a sari on me, and then I used to stand in the front there, because the principal had told me, Miss Anima Mukherjee ma'am at that time, go and wait near the college gate. When you see that red car, come and tell me. So I used to go and stand there, and as soon as I see the red car, I used to race, tell her, and then breathless, I used to stand there at the front when Swami came down. So I never missed a single day. There was only one occasion when Swami was in the campus, because he used to stay 2 days, 3 days, 4 days sometimes. He was in the campus and there was no holiday at school. So I went to Pushpa Madam, who was the assistant warden, and I said, ma'am, can I please not go to school today? Then she said, no, you cannot do that. Swami doesn't like all that. So then I said, but ma'am, Swami is here. I mean, I don't want to go to school. Then she said, don't speak like that, child. Go to school. Swami will be very unhappy. So I felt she was so unfair and was grumbling and all that. And then I went outside the gate. A little distance I had to walk. And that's where the school bus used to come and pick me up. And I was looking towards the college building, and I was feeling so sorry for myself. And I said, you know, Swami, I've come to Anantapur. No mother, nobody to say bye when I go to school. And now you are here and I have to go to the school. What is this, Swami? It's just, what is this? Suddenly, I was looking towards the college. Swami's room has a balcony. When we were students, he used to come out only in the morning after Nagar Sankirtan, when we used to stop in front of the balcony for the last bhajan. And we used to do aarti, and Swami used to give us darshan from there, open the doors, and then he used to give us darshan and sometimes throw apples. That's the only time of the day when he ever came out of the balcony. This was 10 o'clock, and I was grumbling and standing and, you know, so bad. Why do I have to go to school? And suddenly, the doors opened. And if this is the balcony, and I'm standing there, Swami came and stood here. And he stood, and he stood, and he stood. I could make out he was smiling, even from that distance, till the bus came. And I didn't realize at that time that I had removed my shoes, and I was standing with folded hands looking at Swami. I was unaware of what I had done, and suddenly I heard this, you know, repeated sounding of the horn. And all the students of the school who were in the bus, they were all popping their heads out and wondering what's gone wrong. And they were also looking in that direction. And I was reluctant to get back onto my shoes and then get into the bus. And then Swami just did that and then walked back in. That's when I got onto the bus. So he never, ever made me feel that I was far away from home. Let me come to the next phase of this journey. In October of 1972, after this whole problem of Idi Amin started and all that, a few months before that, Swami told us, tell your parents to come away to India because things are not going to be really good there. So we had written letters. Those days, that's all the communication. So we had an interview with Swami on 10th of November, 1972, with my father and everybody. He told my father that only we should have separate interview, and my brother and sister-in-law, he will give them separate interview. So only we were there with my parents, my other sisters. And at that time, my father asked Swami, Swami, tell me the truth. Do you have any complaints about my daughters? Do they give you any trouble? And then Swami said, they are not your daughters. They are my daughters. And they do not give me trouble because by my grace, they don't have any bad thoughts. They are disciplined. I don't have to worry about them. They always do exactly what I want them to do. You know, and then he paid a promise to my father. They are my daughters. I will take care of their happy, healthy, peaceful life in the future. You don't worry about it. Okay. So that's the first time when Swami told my father that we are, my sister Neela and me, we are his daughters. He always treated us like that, as his daughters. Whenever he came to Anantapur, he would ask us, are you all right with the food? Actually, if I can tell the whole story, it'll take the entire time, but I want to cut it short a little bit. But he would ask us, is the food all right? Everything's fine. So we had, you know, so many queries like that from Swami asking about our welfare. Then in 1976, for the summer course at Ooty, I was in 12th standard. And I was at home because we had a short vacation. And I got a letter from my sister saying that you have to speak at that summer course. So the principal has asked me to inform you to come quickly, a few days before we go for the summer course. But I didn't go. Because my mother was in Gujarat and we were staying in Whitefield. Swami asked us to settle down at Whitefield, so we were staying in Whitefield. And I wanted to see my mother's face once before I come back to college. So the previous days, my mother arrived and I told her, Mama, I was waiting for you, now I'm going. So I reached the day before we were supposed to set off for Ooty. And my sister was very angry with me. She said, how can you do this? You know, you are supposed to come 4 or 5 days before because you have to speak, you have to think of the topic on which you're going to speak, you have to prepare and all that. Now, what are you going to tell the principal? Then I said, I will handle that because my mother always came first for me. So, apart from Swami, of course, no question. He doesn't, there's nobody who can substitute him, but in the worldly sense, my mother was always first. So, I went to the principal and said, Sairam ma'am, and then I crossed my fingers and put them behind me, and I didn't want to get scolded. Then she said, so, you have come today, but we are going tomorrow early morning to Ooty because we had to come to Vrindavan, have our breakfast, then all the boys' buses, the girls' buses were supposed to go together, and then we would reach by 8:30, 9, whatever, Ooty, you know. So, it is a long journey. Then she said, what are you going to speak on? Have you thought of something? Then some thought came in my mind, I just told her. I hadn't thought of anything, but I just said, ma'am, I'll talk about religion in the modern world. Oh, that's good. Have you prepared? I said, ma'am, I'm okay. You know, I used to be very fearless. I didn't get much chance to prepare or anything. But next day morning, we set off. And there were all the other students who were degree students, 4 or 5 of them who are preparing to make their speeches. And we're not supposed to speak in front of Swami in the evening. This is a proper lecture we are supposed to give for 1 hour, you know. So she said, okay, I said, I'm all right, ma'am, I can speak, you know. So I used to be quite fearless and confident in those days. When we reached Ooty, it was late in the evening. So Swami asked Jemma madam, who is going to speak tomorrow, first day? And before that, she had asked all the girls who were supposed to speak, and nobody was ready to speak on the first day. They said, we need some more time to prepare. And then I said, ma'am, I will speak. Then you will speak? I said, yes, ma'am, I can speak. So she told Swami that Rajeshwari Patel is going to speak. So he said, that's very good. He said, tell her not to be nervous. And tell her that she is going to be the first speaker among students, and it's going to be the first day of the summer course. So tell her not to be nervous. Tell her to go slow. I was washing my hands outside, and then, you know, he came, and these people came and told me that, you know, Swami was telling. Oh, I said, okay. I was not nervous at all. Then, in the evening, when we went to the place, there was a bungalow where we were all put up. We went by bus and then we were dropped there. The lights went off. The whole night there were no lights, so there was no question of preparing. Next day morning also I was not nervous. The principal asked me at breakfast time, how shall I introduce you? Shall I say you come from Gujarat or you are from Whitefield or what? And I said, ma'am, I need to think about it. I will tell you later. Okay, you tell me later, but before your talk. Okay. All right, then, who spoke first? Not me. Kasturi Garu. And the moment he started speaking, I became nervous. Because then I thought to myself, my God, look at Kasturi Mama, he's speaking so well. And what will happen? So I was sitting on the lady's side there. This is where Kasturi Garu was, and that's where Swami was sitting. And each time I became nervous, he'd give me one look. No. Again, okay. Then again he will look at me. You know, so he was trying to pump some more courage. Okay. So I forgot all about this introduction. And before I got up to speak, Swami did that to the principal. She was sitting in the first line. I was sitting fourth or fifth in that line. He did that. You know how he used to do that. And then he called her and he was talking something in her ears. Then she went to the mic and introduced me. Who gave the introduction? Swami. And he said that Rajeshwari Patel is coming from East Africa. And he told all very positive description about me. I don't want to share this with you. He praised and praised and all that. And then one very important thing which I want to tell you is, her parents are so devoted to Swami that they've given away this daughter to Swami. They never said, I didn't know. And Swami got that announcement made. I was so stunned. So, anyway, after that, so that is again one more occasion when he said that, you know, I'm his daughter. And then, after the speech, midway, you know, I must have finished 30 minutes. And Swami got up. So then I said, Swami, you know, I said, you please sit. Because if Swami is going to stand up, then I'm not going to speak. So, you know, I used to be like that with Swami. So then he said, no, you continue to speak, I will sit there. He went and sat on the bench at the end of the hall, on the other side, on the men's side, and he sat there. And after he settled down, then I said, okay. So I continued. And I spoke for 45 minutes. And as I finished, the first one to clap was Swami. He did his hands like that and clapped. And I suppose that among the boys and the girls who spoke or gave lectures during the summer course, I was the one who spoke the maximum 45 minutes. Nobody else could speak. Nobody spoke for 1 hour. And that is how Swami is. So, you know, many times, even after this talk, he came round and all that, and he told me, spoke, bahut acha. And he told me one more thing. I'm really happy that you're not, you know, moving your hands like that and all that. Remain stable and calm. So keep it up, he said. And go slow. I used to speak a little fast. Go slow. So he often, you know, used to tell me to slow down. I want everybody to listen to your ideas. So go slow. Okay. Now, once, you see, I got that confidence that Swami is my divine parent and guru and friend, I placed myself totally in Swami's hands. All my likes and dislikes, I pushed them aside. And only created new likes and dislikes according to how Swami wants us to be. I can tell you that we were very fortunate, very, very lucky to have Bhagwan as our mentor. He guided me, he guided the students every step of the way. I believe that Bhagwan is the greatest teacher that the world has ever known. We will not get another teacher like him. And that we are his devotees, that we are his students, that we are his daughters or his sons is our great good fortune. You know, earlier when somebody used to say, you know, you're so fortunate, I used to say, no, everybody's fortunate. But recently I realized that I need to acknowledge my good fortune. So yes, of course, I'm very fortunate. You know, because I think we need to realize how fortunate we are. We don't know the value of this Lord who came and walked among us. And sometimes we took him for granted. And that's why we have to remind ourselves all the time of what he did. You know, there was there's an old devotee of Bhagwan. She's now in Puttaparthi, and she told me this very small thing about how, you know, she used to come from Karnataka, from Markara or somewhere, every now and then to Puttaparthi to have Bhagwan's darshan. In those days, we are talking of the days when they had the old mandir and Swami was, you know, giving interviews to each and every person who came there. Before they left, they always got an interview. Once, you know, Swami sent word for her to come over to Parthi through somebody, some known friend. So she took leave at her workplace and she came all the way to Puttaparthi, taking one week's leave. Swami didn't look at her. He didn't talk to her. And she thought to herself, why did he send for me? Then he ought to have let me stay there because I just took leave and, you know. She had taken leave and she went. Again he sent word. So this was the second time she was taking leave from her workplace. So then the day she was leaving, because she had to get back to work, Swami called. And you know what he said? Even if I do not look at you, even if I do not talk to you, you must have my darshan, because you will never get another guru like me. Now, you know, Swami often tells us, do I have about half an hour? Okay. He often tells us that life is a game. Play it. But if we have to play this game of life, we have to play it by the rules? Yes. Because you can't have two teams, whether it's football or cricket or whatever game. One team follows all the rules and the other one doesn't. You can't have a game at all. It's chaos. Now, I discovered the rules of this game of life by observing Swami. Swami was my role model for so many years till he left his physical form. I never stopped observing him. And I learnt about what Swami likes and what he doesn't like by just observing him. Now, what are those rules? I don't want to, you know, go in any particular order. But one of the first things that he taught us as students, I'm sure the later batches of students that came to the college, whether it's the boys or the girls, it's the same, experienced that or not. But over time, Swami insisted that all of us lead a spiritual life. At that young age, and I realize now how important that was. Because if you have, and if we have a spiritual foundation, the ups and downs of life will shake us for a while, but will not destroy us. So he was very, very strict about that. So much so, of course, as I told you, it was fulfillment for me because I was already on that path. But, you know, he even told us how to hold the Japamala. He demonstrated. So that's why I think he's a physical director. You know, a physical director always demonstrates how you have to do whatever. Swami was like that. He used to hold the, you know, imaginary Japamala, and he used to tell us, hold your finger straight, and then, you know, each bead you have to take. And explain to us. And so he taught us how to do japam, how to hold the mala, how to do meditation, which posture is best for girls, what is this light meditation, and how you have to move step by step. He actually demonstrated to us in the library, where he normally used to talk to small groups of students. So, you know, Swami often used to tell us, on the restaurant or hotel of this life, it is written on the top, Anityam Asukham Jagat. Just as if you go to, in those days Swami used to say, military hotel for non-vegetarian restaurants. You know, it used to be called military hotel. I think all the elders know about that. So he used to say, if you enter a military hotel and you ask for vegetarian food, they will say, this is not the place where you'll get it. If you go to a Brahmin hotel, again, Brahmin hotel means vegetarian hotel, and ask for non-vegetarian, you won't get it. In the same way, on the restaurant of this world, it is written, Anityam Asukham Jagat. So if you look for Nityam, if you look for Sukham, you are not going to get it. So you are looking for it in the wrong place. This is how he made us build up a spiritual foundation. Live in the world, do your duty, every act dedicated to God. Enjoy every moment of life. You don't have to renounce the world. See, I have not renounced the world. What is the substitute to renunciation? Moderation. Now that I want to explain to you, because, you know, I used to think, once we come to Swami, you know, we will... A lot of people think that Swami asked us not to get married. He doesn't want us to get married and take to world. It's not true at all. He was so flexible. He advised each person according to their samskar. He didn't say to everybody that, look here, don't you get married. Some people chose not to get married because they wanted proximity. But he never said it, so we cannot blame Swami for where we are. But one thing I understood, while he did not ask us to renounce the world, he did ask us one thing, moderation. In words, talk less, work more. Very famous quote of Swami's. Moderation in words, moderation in food, moderation in dress. No, he never appreciated overdressing. I'll come to that sometime later. Then moderation even in enthusiasm. Everything should be in limit. Even our devotion for Swami, it should not cross limits. We shouldn't behave like a mad person in front of Swami. He used to at least tell us that. So moderation in words, moderation in food, moderation in money. Too much money is not good. If the shoe is too big, you can't wear it. If it's too small, you can't walk freely. So just enough, not more. Moderation in money. Moderation in sleep. You know how Swami always insisted on, you know, going to bed at 10 o'clock and getting up at 5 o'clock. That much sleep is enough for all of us. Only children, babies, you know, sleep longer than that. So, moderation in sleep. Moderation even in laughter. You know, when Swami used to sometimes come to the prayer hall at Anantapur and then crack a joke and we started, laughing, he would say, bus, bus, bus. You know, so after a point, don't laugh. And then he says, you know, when you laugh like that, especially girls should not laugh like that, showing all the teeth. These were the things he told us. And when you all laugh like that in a group, it sounds like that aerodrome, you know, sound. So he used to say, bus, bus. You know, so we had to stop. So much so, you see, you know, based on these directives of Swami, I actually changed myself a lot. So for so many years, Some of my contemporaries, they said, we haven't seen you smile with your teeth showing. That's what I did to myself. I completely changed my personality, fitting it to his image, because I wanted to be accepted by Swami for his mission. I just wanted Swami to choose me to do his work. So I was ready to do anything for that. So moderation even in laughter, moderation even in exercise. Shouldn't exercise too much. 15 minutes every day, we have to do yoga. That's what he told us. In fact, he got Indira Devi to come and teach us. You know, the famous yoga teacher, she used to come to Anandpur and she taught us yoga. 15 minutes, maximum 20 minutes. Don't overdo it. You know, some people do it for a very long time. Sometimes, for some people especially, it results in ill health. So he was everything in moderation. So that is very... This is how Swami made us feel that we don't have to renounce the world. If we enjoy everything in moderation, it's fine. We can stay in the world and be like the lotus. That Dharmakshetra is, you know, that lotus, untouched by the mud of the world. So that is what, you know, we were taught to practice. Then he also instructed us, you know, very directly about behavior. Let me give you one example. Swami used to often, that's what I said about the present students or the recent passed out students may not be aware of that. Swami used to even tell us how to walk. Because when we used to have some puja or something, when Swami came in, each of us got up, he would watch each one how we were walking and how we came in and kneeled. And then he would check. Don't sway your body so much when you're walking. Can you imagine the avatar coming down to that level and molding us? That's why I said we were so lucky to have him as our mentor. He even used to say the hair should be in place. We should have the bindi, of course, that is for women. And you know, by the way, at that time, I had very thick, curly hair, so curly and so thick that my mother had to call the neighbors, two women from the neighborhood, to help her to wash my hair. It was really very, very thick. You can't imagine if you see me now, but that's how thick it was. So if I tied two plaits and I kept them like this, they would stay like that. So thick and wiry the hair was. So my mother, before we came to India, had got me to have a bob cut. So I got the hair cut because she said, I just can't handle your hair, and washing your hair is one big responsibility for me. By the time we came to Swami, by then I had a little bit short hair. Not bob, but I allowed it to grow. So I used to put pins, okay. But then, you know, Swami, in one of his interactions with the students, he said that, you know, we should have long hair, we should plait our hair. And so I started growing my hair. Okay, so what I'm trying to say is I just changed my personality according to Swami's image. I wanted to be the kind of daughter Swami would be proud of. So I changed everything about my personality. So even to that extent. So you see what happened once, you know, there was one classmate of mine. I don't want to give any names here. She also had short hair, and we were staying in South Prashanti. It was vacation. And she told me, you know, Rajeshwari, today I'm going to put some pins and leave my hair. What do you think? You know, in those days, even the juniors and seniors used to ask my advice. So I told her, I don't think it's a good idea. Swami will not like it. Then she said, no, let me try, you know, today. Then I said, it's your wish. We went for darshan. Swami finished the rounds and we came back to the room. Around 10:30, Swami sent Kutum Rao to the room. There was a knock on the door and he asked, is so-and-so inside, you know, that girl's name. And then she thought, what is this? Swami sent word. So she opened the door and she said, "Yes, Sairam uncle." And he said, "Swami has sent word to do your hair properly. He doesn't want to see you like this tomorrow." And after that, this girl cried for half an hour. Not because she was scolded by Swami, but because she had hurt Swami. You know, that is how we were in those days. If we made Swami unhappy, that would give us so much unhappiness. So she cried and then she said, "I wish I had listened to you." You know, these kind of things, small things, can you even imagine? Just like a mother or, you know, a father would correct you like that. You know, he used to correct us. Then you see the other which quality that Swami expected us to cultivate, which I watched and observed in Swami, was flexibility. Now, you will not be able to understand. You will think, on the one side, Swami is very strict about this, that, and the other thing. And then he's also flexible? Of course he was. So if any one of us wanted to follow the karma marga according to our nature, he allowed us to do that, do seva, do social work. Not for everybody. It's not for everybody. Another person wanted to follow the bhakti marga, he allowed them to do that. I think I've not seen a more flexible God than Swami. Within the limitations of restrictions, he gave us a lot of space. And that's why, I mean, I look at myself now as an elder, as a teacher in the campus, and I think that we are more strict with the students than Swami was. He lovingly corrected us, but he was never rigid. And this is an amazing combination, you know. On the one hand, he wanted us to be in one way, be disciplined, etc. At the same time, he gave room for that flexibility. In a very subtle way, he allowed us to be ourselves. And that is such a beautiful thing. And, you know, you and I will put each one in a tight compartment. So everybody has to be copycats. You know, all of us have to be copies, just like factory products. He didn't do that. He allowed each one to be unique, at the same time, to an extent, molded to his satisfaction. That's all. So he was, in that sense, a very, I should say, progressive God. You know, in our time, we used to wear saris. And our contemporaries, you know, they used to attend the university sports events and all that and come back with shields and cups and whatever. But they did all the running of the races by tucking their sari up, and they did all the activity, whether athletics or it is games, they did with saris on. But later on, all of you know, when the sports event started, Swami said, "Let them wear salwar kameez, but with dupatta, of course." Now, don't you think he's progressive? He has allowed the students to wear salwar kameez in the mandir after they come back from the grounds. And when I look at that, I think how Swami was with us. He didn't allow us to wear anything except saris, but that is what makes him so progressive. Whereas you and I, everybody has to be like that for the next 100 years. Swami is so progressive. He's looking at the next generation, allowing, but then not giving too much freedom, little by little, so that it doesn't go out of control. So he will give you 1 inch at a time. Whereas parents, you know, what they do is they give them extreme freedom. So then the children go out of control. So look at Swami's way of molding the personality of his students. So I think that is something so wonderful. Another thing which I want to mention, I mean, I'll probably forget to mention everything, so I just put it down. I told Swami, whatever you want me to share with them, I will share. When the time is up, I will say, that's it, it's what you wanted me to tell them. Another very important thing is love for the motherland. Though I was not born in India, I was always Indian at heart. And when I came to Swami, he often told us, Matrubhasha, mother, motherland, these are very important. So, you know, whenever we used to have the national anthem and look at the flag, even today, my eyes fill up. I'm so proud to salute that flag. proud to be an Indian. He always insisted, be a good citizen of this country. Follow its culture. Be Indian. Don't imitate Western fashions, Western ways of life. That doesn't suit us. We have a different ethos. Let's be Indian, but let's be modern, not Western. So that is another point which I noticed in Swami, was he taught us ancient wisdom. See, he is the Adi Purush. He could have, you know, stuck on to that ancient wisdom and at any cost not allowed us to budge from it. No. But even then, that ancient wisdom, he made us learn to practice it in a modern way. So that is one very beautiful thing about Swami. One last thing, I guess it's kind of time, right? One example I just want to give you, maybe in the context of, or maybe two examples, okay? One is respect for all religions. He used to often talk to us about that, and that's how, you know, every other day our students used to sing Sarva Dharma bhajans also. And he used to explain to us the inner significance of the Sarva Dharma symbol and all that. It inspired me so much that I started reading books on comparative religion in our library. And once for one summer course, I spoke for 45 minutes on the major religions of the world. As I told you, and I always spoke on a subject, because at that time Swami was talking about respect for all religions, that all religions lead you to the same God. So then I really sat down and studied the religions, the scriptures of the various religions, the books on that. I did rigorous study, and that's the same truth that I arrived at with my effort as well. And that is what I spoke about during the summer course. So that is one more thing which Swami wants us all to practice. Not just tolerance of all religions, respect and acceptance of all religions as just different pathways to the same God. One final thing, or rather personal experience I want to share with you. You know, an example of Bhagwan's divine humility. You know, we were all staying in the Pathshala blocks. In those days, they used to call Pathshala blocks. You know, there used to be a Pathshala, Ved Pathshala, and then above that, there were some rooms which were given to the girl students. And all the old students, when they finish one course, they will be staying in the Pathshala block for some time till Swami directs us to, you know, tells us what to do next. And whenever there was some work in the canteen, in the Indian canteen used to become greasy after a few days, the floor. He used to say, tell the Anandpur girls to go and scrub the grease. Okay. So, you know, what happened is, a few days before that, we were all seated there in the front group and Swami came and scolded us. We didn't know why he scolded us. He said, what is the use of all your education? No satya, dharma, shanti, prema. It was all zero, he said. Sunna, he said. All waste your education. And I was sitting right at the back, as usual, because I knew if Swami wants to talk, he will talk from wherever, he will even call you from behind. So I was sitting behind, and I was finding it amusing. Initially, I found it amusing, because I've never seen Swami so angry. His eyes became red, and he called us all names, donkeys and buffaloes and everything. You know, so enraged. So, you know, I thought, after some time, it sunk. Then I thought, what? Why is Swami so angry? And he said, no more sitting here. All of you sit in the back. Why should you have this special place to sit? You girls don't have any of these values, satya, dharma, shanti, prema, all sunna, he said. It was waste all your education and all that. So he scolded us. Actually, we didn't know at that time. One lawyer amma used to be there in those days. She had written a letter. You know, women often write about women to Swami. So she wrote a letter saying, why these girls have to sit in the front? Okay, whatever it is, we came to know only later that it was this lawyer amma who was responsible. But Swami, you know, never liked remarks about his students. He was very particular. Even if he knew we were not in the wrong, if somebody wrote a letter, he would make that person happy. He scolded us so badly, we went to the room and all of us were upset. What did we do that, you know, Swami scolded us like this? Then we thought, okay, Swami doesn't want us to sit here. We used to sit next to that Krishna on the wall on Swami's dining table side. There was a Krishna Murti, on the wall. So we used to sit there. As he comes, we were the people seated right there. So we went to the bhajan hall. It's all right, at least we'll go and sit in the bhajan hall. We used to get front place, like how the boys sit. We also used to sit in the front in those days. Now, of course, we are behind the elderly women. When we went there, the lady in charge said, Swami's instructions, not supposed to sit here. So we got really worried. What is this? Swami is not allowing you to sit here, he's not allowing you to sit there. Now this went on for 1 week. And I told the girls, we didn't do anything wrong. Why is he scolding us? We don't even know what we have done. It's okay, he doesn't want to see our face. We'll go and stand outside that compound wall. There used to be a compound wall in those days. We'll stand there and we'll do bhajan from there. Or have darshan from there. It's all right. We all said it's all right, but every time when we stood there for darshan or bhajan, we used to face that Swami's door from where we can see a little bit of the Swami's chair and all that. And all of us used to cry, but we were saying, okay, Swami told us not to go inside, we are going to be here only. We were upset like that for so long. Finally, we got this message that we have to go and, clean the Indian canteen, the kitchen area where the grease, layer of grease, scrub. And we were so angry. When it comes to work, then he remembers his girls, and we scrubbed with that kind of an anger, and we made it spick and span, and we were all seated there. And we still have the tradition in Anandpur, we don't go singly to the room. We always go in a group. So we're waiting for everybody to assemble after washing up and then come there, and then we were going to go. We were just waiting there. I had finished, so I was sitting there near the door when Kutum Rao Garu came. And he said, Anandpur girls. I said, yes, uncle. Swami has sent a message. We thought, what more now? Swami wants to apologize to all of you. Because there seems to have been a misunderstanding. A misunderstanding has been created, and Swami has not seen you for the last 1 week. You know how thrilled we were? Swami apologized. That's why I said divine humility. If a student does some wrong, we scold that student. Even afterwards, when we realize that we were wrong and the student was right, we feel we should not confess. Swami taught us that lesson. If you are as an elder in the wrong, nothing wrong will happen if you say sorry to somebody who's younger to you. And Swami, he apologized. And there were some girls who had not come to the seva work. They were in the room because they were sick, and so we wanted to go and tell them. So each one wanted to be the first one to reach there and tell the girls, Swami apologized. So I said, don't run, and still everybody was running. Don't run, Swami doesn't like Swami girls to run, but we were all running. Okay, running and then stopping, and then running and stopping. Finally we reached there, and we were all, seated in our usual place, ready, because Swami said, Swami wants you to show yourself, because he's not seen you. So all of us, lifted ourselves up a little bit in the morning, and then he came for darshan. And you know what Swami did? He just walked past us. That is the lesson. Swami apologized because he had scolded us based on somebody's letter to satisfy this person. But he was unhappy because we were hurt. And so he apologized. But he didn't want us to be egoistic about it. So these are some of the things that, I learned. Anyway, let me conclude at this point. Every time at the end of the final year course, when the final year students go to Puttaparthi to offer that gratitude program, then we teachers also accompany them, and I don't sit in the front. It's the day for the students, so they sit in the front. But wherever I'm seated, I mentally tell Swami, Swami, I'm now offering to you these finished products. I hope that you are happy with the way I have molded their personality. Now use them for your mission. Once, you know, when after I had directed a play called Mirdad, Swami called us again to Puttaparthi to enact it once more because a UGC team had come and he wanted to show off the abilities and talents of this of his students. And so this was a philosophical play. I'm winding up, okay? So please don't be impatient. Then you see, after the play was over, next day morning, that is a story by itself, but I'm not going to tell you that to you today. But we were seated when he came out, and he came with two saris, like that, director, and then, because he didn't give saris to us, to the teachers, me and one more teacher was assisting me. Then I said, Swami, you are the one who did everything. No. And said, gave her that sari. And in that happiness, we forgot to tell him that we are going back to Anantapur. And you know, whenever we went for any function, when Swami invited you or called you, you were supposed to tell him before leaving. That's the courtesy. You see, this is another thing which he taught us. If you go to somebody's house, you have to tell them, even if they are busy, just say that now we're leaving. So that's. And suddenly the principal told me, Principal Hemlata, you saw her on the screen. She said, what, Rajeshwari? We forgot to tell Swami that we are leaving and we have to leave, you know. Then I said, no, ma'am, what do we do? And then Swami has already gone for bhajan to the prayer hall. And usually from there he'll go step into his room and that's it for the day. Then I said, ma'am, let's go and sit in the veranda. Then she said, how can we go and sit in the veranda? What is this? You also forgot, I also forgot. I said, ma'am, just follow me. I used to be very fearless. I said, follow me. I went front, she came behind, and we went inside on the veranda. And will you believe it? Swami came out after he gave the interview to the UGC representatives who had come. He came out and he knows everything. He pretended as if he suddenly saw us and he said, oh, so you are here. Then he told us, they were all appreciating this play and said that it should be enacted in all the cities of India and all that, etc., etc. Said, Swami, we are leaving. He was not willing to listen to that. He's telling the principal, my students come from different backgrounds, different samskar. But if the teacher is proper, I don't have to worry. The teacher will mold them accordingly. So he was really happy that day. And then he looked at me. This he told her in Telugu, but I could follow Telugu a little bit by then. Then he looked at me and what he said, you know, you gave me today a reason to hold my head high. So I pray to Bhagwan. I'm still work in progress. I'm not a finished product yet. But the end of my life, when I stand before Bhagwan, I hope he will say, you gave me a reason to hold my head high. Yes, sir.